All right, so hopefully you took a moment to write a little bit more on your biography and so forth to start to craft your presence on Twitter. We don't want to start to get followers just yet until we do one more thing. The settings. We're going to look at the settings of the account because the default, I don't like one big setting that is the default, which is that at the very top left here, it told me I have one notification. So something happened. I got maybe a new follower or a retweet or something. Something happened. But the default is you're not going to get those notifications unless you followed the person or the account. So the default is you will not get any notifications unless you're already connected with someone. That I think is worthless because I want to know who followed me. Because I didn't follow someone, perhaps. They followed me, but I don't know who it was. I wouldn't know until I manually go there. I would never get that little number pop up. So what I'm saying is there's a setting here that I recommend we change. Go to the little icon, your profile icon, click on profile icon there, and select settings. So you probably still have the egg. Click on your egg and then settings. So once you put your own logo, you will see your logo there. Click on settings. There's a lot of settings here. I can't quite go into every one of them. We'll spend a lot of time just on settings. But on the left side, you have all of these sections. You want to go over to the one that's web notifications. See how there's one that says web notifications. Right now, we're using the website. We're using the Twitter website. We want to change the notifications for here. It says receive notifications in your web browser. These settings do not change your notifications timeline. So, activity related to you and your tweets. Notify me when, and you have a bunch of things here. You want to have all of these turned on. I believe they're all turned on already. But you probably have then each of these set to tailored for you. I don't like that setting. I don't recommend you have that setting. I recommend that you change all of these to by anyone. Tailored for you basically means if I have followed an account, then I will get a notification from them. I will get a notification that they replied to my tweet, that they favorited my tweet, etc. But I'm brand new. I have no connections. Therefore, I'm going to be in the dark and I'm not going to know who's interacting with me. So you can change this later, and this is what the celebrities have. This is what the bigwigs have. They've got theirs set to tailored by me because Justin Bieber's got 10 million, 30 million people. The president has 40 million people. This college has 1,000 people. You know, they've got a lot of connections, and it's a lot of noise. So when you've got a lot of connections, maybe you'll set it tailored for you to weed out all of that noise and just focus on the real connections. But as a beginner with no followers, I would recommend let me know when anyone interacts with me in any of these ways. Yes.
So then what does that tailored by you actually mean? Is there then a set of specifications for how you want it tailored, or is it just
Unfortunately not. It's what Twitter believes tailored for you means, but in general, it gives preference for those that you've connected with already. So that's what I would do right away. It's not on by default. For regular people, this might be good because regular people that use Twitter to connect with friends and family, obviously, they're connected and they care about the notifications. But for a business where you want to catch the widest net possible to get more followers and interactions and such, this is the better setting. Once you change all of these to by anyone, make sure you click Save Changes. Save those changes. Because I want to know when I'm followed by someone new, when I get a direct message from a client. I want to know when there's a reply to a tweet that I mentioned in. I want to know this stuff.
And where are you going to see that exactly? When you do get notified?
In the notification screen. So that's one screen to change. Let's go then to this other option here, email notifications. this you have to decide what you like. On ours, there's a bunch of them here, unfortunately. It's pretty detailed, but for example, here's what we've got. This is the company one. So notice for us, these first few ones are turned off because it says, okay, email me when my tweets are marked as favorites. Email me when I'm mentioned in a marked as favorite. Email me when my tweets are retweeted. Well, this, you might want that. You might want to get emails when stuff happens on Twitter. I think this is a moot point because it tells you all of that on the app. So this, I believe, is going to clutter your inbox. By leaving all of those on, you're going to get all of these emails. You're going to get burnt out by getting a lot of emails over and over from Twitter, especially when you get popular. That's why the app itself has notifications and a little pop-up and I got a new follower. So you can decide what to do here, but I sort of highly recommend turn all of these off here. Don't send me an email when I get a reply. That's what the app is for, because you can't really do much in the email. You just get the notification on your email. It's still going to drive you back to Twitter to actually reply, so I don't think that's that useful. These over here are on, and this is not right or wrong, but we want the email also to know when we got followed. Yes, the app itself will pop up that say you've got a new follower, but we also want to capture that in an email, maybe to do something else with it later. Email me when someone from my address book joins Twitter. When we created the account and it asked you for your email, there was probably a spot that asked you to confirm your address book, or it said, these people that you know are on Twitter. Why not follow them? One of the reasons that it knew other people that you might know is because you added your email. You might think, well, that's a privacy violation. It's a minimal thing to do. If you put in your email address, it will tell you you've got these other Twitter connections. And so if someone knew, if I used my company email and someone that I have on my company email contact list also joins Twitter, I'll get a notification that says John Smith also joined Twitter. Maybe I want to connect with them. That might be useful. So if you don't want any of these, you can turn them off. Let's see, activities related to your retweets, these are also off because again, if you have the burden of popularity, if your Twitter account does take off and you get a lot of followers and favorites and retweets and all of that, great. But then you're going to get your inbox flooded. And you might not want all of that stuff on your inbox. You're going to see it on the website here under notifications. You're going to see it on the app. I don't need to see it a third time in my inbox. So I turn those off. As well as activity from your network. I turned all of those off because email me with top tweets and stories. This is so that you continue to be excited and to use Twitter. Twitter will once in a while send you emails about the top tweets and stories, meaning if you've made connections with accounts, they will then send you emails once in a while if you haven't logged in, especially recently. They'll tell you, hey, this account tweeted about that because you might be interested in it. It says sent sporadically, daily, weekly, whatever you want. Maybe leave them on to give them a try, but from personal experience, they get a little tiring. Updates about activity from my Twitter network, updates about the performance of my tweets, recommendations based on activity in my network. You could leave them on, see if they work for you, and then turn them on or off. For us, it's tiresome because we log in every day. We manage the Twitter every day and we deal with it. So to get another email to clutter the inbox, no thanks. Updates from Twitter. Email me about news about Twitter products. That's fine, no. Tips on getting more out of Twitter. No, we have experience. You might not have experience, so that might be useful to you. You have to decide on this screen. Everything is turned on this screen. And then you go home and you'll see, why do I have 17 tweets from Twitter? This is why. Suggestions based on recent follows. That might be useful to you. If you're a pizza company, a pizza shop, and you want to get more people to buy your pizza, and you did a little research and found pizza lovers in San Diego and you followed them, well, you might get an email from other pizza followers, pizza likers that you might want to follow. So that might be useful. If you need some individual help and suggestions on what to fill in here, see me during the break and such, but in general, that's what I have here. Any general questions about anything on this screen or the previous web notifications screen? All right, two more things under settings and then we'll actually start to use Twitter. If you go to account on the left side, this is where you can change your username. So if you no longer want a particular name, you can change it there. That Twitter username is your Twitter vanity address. You cannot have spaces, you cannot have special characters, only underscores, no dashes. If you need to change the email address, there it is there. If you put in your personal instead of business, you can change it. Check your language and time zone. You might have different options here. Tweet media. Do not inform me before showing media that may be sensitive. So because Twitter is an open forum, just like a public square, there may be things that you don't want to actually see, photos and such. So if the photo is marked as having sensitive sensitive media, there's going to be, the default is that it will not show you the sensitive media, however that's defined. If you don't care, you can turn that option on and you won't be informed when everything shows up uncensored. Mark media I tweet as containing material that may be sensitive. So if you're product is a bit of a more of an adult nature and you don't want some people to view it, you should mark that so that it doesn't accidentally show up to the wrong people and then you get reported and your account gets closed and all of that. So it's under media there. You can have videos in a tweet. We'll talk about what kind of content to add to it, we can add to a tweet, but now video is becoming more prevalent also on Twitter. So here the default is that tweets or that videos will play automatically, not the sound, thankfully, but the animation of the video will play automatically. You're scrolling through tweets and then the video will start to play, but not the sound. If you don't want that distraction, you can turn that off. Don't play the video until I click the play. Twitter is global, so maybe someone is reaching out to you in another language that's interested in your product. Twitter provides a built-in translate feature. So if they're writing to you in Spanish or Tagalog or Hebrew, there'll be a button right below it that says View Translation. And a machine will translate it, and you might be able to understand it in general. It might not get the nuance and such, but you'll get in general what they're tweeting. If you don't want to see that, you can turn that off. I think it is useful because, again, it's global.
Can you ask for it to translate manually?
Well, that's what I'm saying. You're going to see the original tweet in the other language, and if you want the translation, then you click, and it will translate it for you. It's not automatically translated. As you use Twitter, you're going to be putting out a lot of tweets, you're going to be putting photos, you're going to be putting content. You can request to download your whole archive, so every single one of your tweets and stuff will be downloaded. One big Excel file. So that's your archives. Any questions on this screen? Okay, the last settings that we'll look at, security and privacy. Security and privacy. Very important. Obviously, we hear all the time that accounts get hacked, banks get hacked, Twitter accounts get hacked, governments get hacked. So this is an important thing to keep in mind. Under security, we've got login verification, don't verify login requests, send login verification by phone, send login verification to the app. So right now it's asking you, if you go home and log in, it's just going to ask you for your username and password. For more security, you can also ask it for, it can ask you for your phone number to send you a text message. So another layer of security. Your username, your password, and a text. Because if someone tries to break into your account, maybe they can guess your password. but they don't have your phone, hopefully, for that extra layer of protection. You've also got the option of send a verification to your app. So again, that's the app that gets installed to your phone. It's a second layer of protection in addition to your password to log into your account. The thing about cybersecurity is, unfortunately, we have to weigh security with convenience. It's very convenient to use the same password over and over and over on my bank and on my Twitter account and on my Gmail and on my school address. Very convenient. Very insecure. Because if someone figures out your password on Twitter, now they've got your password for your bank and your business account and everything. It's more secure to use a different password for every service. So I've got a password just for my business account, just for my Twitter account, just for my bank account. But it's very inconvenient because I've got to memorize 5 passwords. So there's a balance in there somewhere. And for some of us, it'll be easy to reach, and for some of us, it'll be very hard, and so we opt for convenience, and therefore we have low security, and we get hacked. And we say, why did I get hacked? Because you opted for more convenience than more security. So that's what this is about. Require personal info to reset my password. Just more ways to be secure. More inconvenience, but more security. Yes?
Well, I'm trying to click on it and it's not clicking.
What you have to do is...
You don't want it to, like it says don't, and you want to change it.
So what you're saying is you want to use either login verification or Twitter app?
Right.
Well, you need the Twitter app, first of all. You need to have downloaded the Twitter app to your device and logged into it, and then you can come back here and turn it on.
Okay.
You needed to also add a phone number and verify the phone number, and then you can turn this on to use the phone number. Again, there's other ways here of security. You need to look at these yourself and click read more, educate yourself, and decide which will work best for you. For myself personally, I opt more for security than convenience. I do have literally 15 passwords for every account, but I have a system to make new passwords. For me, I opt more for the security, less convenient. I can live with it. Other people in my organization, unfortunately, they're a little bit more about convenience and security. And I'm always hammering them about it, be more secure, because we're dealing with important stuff. So for your own personal, you have to decide what works best for you. Privacy. Allow anyone to tag me in photos. Allow only people I follow. Do not allow anyone to tag me. This is a bit, I think, a bit more important for people that have a personal Twitter account. If I've got a business account, someone posts a picture of one of my cupcakes, and then they tweet that cupcake, and then they tag that. This is Victor's Cupcakes photo, Victor's Bakery cupcake. I want that. I want people to see that was me in the photo. But if I'm a personal account, maybe I don't want that. So you can decide how to set that. There's a privacy. This is what I said previously. When you create a Twitter account, everything that you tweet is public. Therefore, everyone can see it. We want that for a business account because we want more customers, more followers. For a personal account, I might want it private. And then if selected, only those you approve will receive my tweets. For a company, I don't think that's quite relevant, but you might have a company that has exclusive content and you only want to select clientele. Sure. So you can make your company private. But that could be shooting yourself in the foot, because then your tweets will not be searchable, will not be visible. How will you get more clients, more followers, if no one can see any of your tweets? At the very least, they will be able to see your graphic, your logo here in your bio, maybe, but then that's not enough to request a follow. You've got location. So for a personal account, you might not want to be giving away your location every time you tweet. I remember several years ago, one of the big panics was there was a website, it might still be around, called something like pleaserobme.com. That was about this automated website that would be searching tweets that had location built in. Because people would say, I'm at the mall, with a location. So then that website would copy that tweet, put it on the website, pleaserobme.com, because I'm not at home. Someone would be tweeting, I'm having a great time in Barbados. So that would be copied and put on pleaserobme.com, and then people would know, I'm not at home.
There was more of a story about Twitter and the location, and I think it was happening then. There was one robber who was, there was some like guy who was sitting by police, and he just hid in some kind of like house, and just tweeted, I'm kind of like in this house, just no one can find me.
Yeah.
And they just kind of like, they kind of try to find him and look at their kind of like social stuff. Came to this house, tried to kind of like find him. He just like really hide somewhere, like under sofa or whatever. And they didn't find him, but we went away. And he just tweeted, stupid police guy, he didn't find me under the sofa.
So they were almost trying to get caught. They were trying to hide, but they were still tweeting about it. And there's been examples of robbers that have Facebooked in the middle of the robbery, and then they get caught. So
it's totally the same.
So people can be dumb. So you may decide you want a location or not. One possibility that you might want a location is, let's say I've got my business set up on Twitter, I've got it on my app. I'm at the location of my business, and we're having a one-day parking lot sale. Everything must go. I'm going to tweet, hey everyone, join us today for what everything must go. Add the location, and people that are in the area that are interested can click on the location button and see a map to go to the sale. So if you are a physical business and you want people to come to your business, you might add a location to your tweet so that people can come to the business. And that can be turned on and off actually at the moment that you tweet. Mine is off here, but when you tweet, on the mobile device, especially, you can turn on show my location, and therefore people can come to your location if you're at the business on Main Street, not at your house. So that can be turned on and off as necessary.
What was that website again? I want to rob.
Please rob me. I think it's pleaserobme.com, something like that. Discoverability. Let others find me by my email. So if I use my company email and I turn that on, that might be useful because someone might know me by my email and they search Twitter, they find my account through my business email, they find my business, they follow. But if you used your personal email account for your business, which you can, there's nothing wrong with that really, but if you say, let people find me through that personal email, you might not want your personal email out there to be searchable on Twitter. Some of you that saw when you were setting this up, it was asking, you might know these people based on your contact list. Here's where you can manage that. If you do want to connect your Yahoo email or your Gmail or your Outlook or whatever, you can go to that screen, they'll make a connection, they'll scan your contact list and say, oh, these 7 people are on Twitter. Would you like to follow them? That might be useful. That might be way too intrusive. But it's on that screen right there. And here again is the tailor Twitter based on my recent website visits. If you do or do not want it, it's right there. This is the other one related to ads and so forth. Promoted content. Tailor ads based on information shared by ad partners. This lets Twitter display ads about things you've already shown interest in. Learn more about how this works and your additional privacy controls. So again, the various cookies on Twitter or outside of Twitter, if you've replied to a particular account on Twitter, if you turn this on, Twitter will try to show you the best relevant ads to you. Just because you turn these off does not mean you will not get any ads. You will just get ads that are more tailored to what you might care about.
Are you going to talk about placing ads on
Twitter? I'll mention it very briefly, but you know, we've only got 3.5 hours.
I thought I saw something where you could now sort by geography.
Mm-hmm. So Twitter for Teams here then, this is how you can have multiple people managing a Twitter account. For a long time, this was a big problem in that I created the business account on Twitter, but there's seven other people that should be also tweeting. Well, everyone needed to use the same email to log in and the same password. And I said, as I said a moment ago, I practice more inconvenience but more security. Maybe the other six people in the company are a little more lax about it. So if one of those people gets hacked, suddenly the whole company account got hacked. So here it says, allow anyone to add me to their team. And that's the default. So we can have multiple people managing one Twitter account with their own login information. So if they get hacked with their login information, no problem. I can deactivate them from access from my account and I'm safe. This needs a little bit more setup, unfortunately. It's not as easy as Facebook or Google Plus, but we've got here, learn more. We would be using something called TweetDeck, which is an official team management software from Twitter. So if we leave that on, allow anyone to add me to their team, and then you go to learn more, you read up on it, how this works exactly. It's not super complicated, but it's one of your tasks.
What's TweetDeck for him?
It's for managing your Twitter account, for more than one person to manage this one Twitter account. And you have other options here. Do not allow anyone to add me to their team. I don't think that's very useful, because then only one login and one password will be shared with all seven people. The first option, I believe, is the best, because then each one of those seven people can have their own login and their own password, and therefore it's more secure. Direct messages. As I said at the top here, there's a way to converse with people on Twitter privately, one-on-one. No one else will see it except those in this conversation. The thing is that by default, that private messaging can only happen if two accounts mutually follow each other. If I follow this school and the school follows me back, I can then have private messages back and forth. If I follow them only, then it doesn't work. Unless you turn on this option at the bottom here, receive direct messages from anyone. I'm saying anyone can send me a direct private message anywhere, anytime, anyhow. That might be way too open for people. That's why it's off by default. One reason why you might turn it on is to reach more potential clients. But I think, unfortunately, cynically, I think that opens you up way too much for spammers. Because perhaps spammers are just gonna, you know, be using their spam bots to try to find accounts and try to send out direct messages to anyone that is open. I haven't personally seen that myself, but that's just me thinking two steps ahead how the bad guys might abuse things. So it's off by default. Any questions on anything on the screen? Okay, if you did change anything here, remember to click Save Changes at the bottom. At the very top right corner, let's click back on your logo and click View Profile. Again, mine is already set up. We've got content. These are where all of our tweets show up, all of our 996 tweets. They show up on your timeline. This is what people will see when they browse your profile. At the very top left, this is my vanity address, twitter.com/pmdinteractive. You can have capital letters in there. If someone doesn't type the capital letters, it still will work. It doesn't matter in this case. We just put capital letters in there so that it's a little more readable than just running it all together, lowercase. But anyway, if someone searches on Twitter and finds my profile, this is what they will see. If someone goes to my profile directly, this is what they will see. If I give out a business card and it has my profile, this is what they will see. That's why it's important to set this up as professionally as possible, as completely as possible. What?
I went to view profile and then went to next.
That's it. I just clicked view profile. So then here it's also going to show the tweets that we've published, so that when someone sees them, this is what they're about, this is what they've published, therefore, that's good stuff. I'll follow them. And you can't see it on mine, but if you go to my profile, you would see a follow button somewhere. Well, at the moment, I think for what yours says, if I look over someone's shoulder, if you're brand new, I believe it's all empty and it just says, tweet your first tweet. Something like that, right?
Choose your first tweet.
Choose your first tweet, okay. So you've got a couple of suggestions and you've got your own tweet, of course. So you've got two suggestions. Choose your first tweet. And those are just the traditional first tweets. The very, very first tweet that ever went out was a very short one that said, just setting up my Twitter. And it was from one of the founders of the company. So that's one of the suggestions there. Maybe if you want to follow tradition, you can click that, and that'll be your very first tweet. Just setting up my Twitter. That's fine. You've also got the second option. Or you've got a button somewhere there that says, or craft my own first tweet, whatever it calls it. So either click one of those tweets to be your first tweet, or click the button so you can write your own tweet. And yeah, it's your very first tweet. You might be a lot of pressure. What do I write here? This is my first message ever. Well, as you get better at this and the techniques we'll be talking about, you'll get more comfortable with this. But going back to what we talked about Google+, think about putting content out on social media that is relevant to your followers. Yes, we don't have any followers at the moment, but I want to tweet 3 to 5 tweets before I try to get followers to give them a flavor of what my profile is about. If someone visited my profile now, they'd see a lot of great stuff, more enticement to follow. If you're brand new, maybe your very first tweet would be, you know, we're excited to be on Twitter. Follow us for exclusive content. Or, hello world, we're on Twitter now. This is where you're going to see some amazing photos. You know, tweet something in 140 characters that entices people to follow you. 140 characters. So you cannot write a whole paragraph here like Google+ or Facebook. You have 140 characters. And as you start to write, that character count goes down. And then at a certain point, if you go over the edge, I had a really great idea here, but now I'm past the limit and it won't let me tweet it. Once you go past 140 characters, you're in negative territory and you cannot tweet. I'm going to tweet something here. This is from the business account. I've got 74 characters left. I have the option to add a photo, so I'm not limited to just text. I can attach a photo. If you click add photo, that does count toward your character count, I believe 15 characters. But you can attach 4 photos. And all those 4 photos still only use those 15 characters. So instead of just boring text, you can add a picture, up to 4. Now this location is disabled, but it won't be too much useful on the desktop. It'll be much more useful if I add location on my mobile, because my mobile has GPS. So it's not too obvious, but I can also attach a link here and a video. If I'm on a mobile device, if I'm using the app on Android or iPhone, I also have a button to attach a video or to record a video. I believe it's only 30 seconds long, but 30 seconds is a Super Bowl ad. So you have the ability to add video, either a video that you've shot and then it'll crop it to 30 seconds, or shoot a brand new video and say, hey everyone, join us today in the store for 10% off. Tweet it, and then your followers would see that. And video is very popular. It's becoming very useful. People want to see video, want to be entertained. That's a whole topic in and of itself. We are going to talk about using YouTube in part two of this class because video is so important. Yes?
So if you shoot a video in your phone that's related to Twitter, can you reuse that somehow? Is it possible logistically to reuse that onto your website blog?
Definitely. Now, when you say relevant to Twitter, what do you mean by that?
Well, I mean that you did it through the Twitter app. Isn't that what you said? It's the Twitter app that has the capability of allowing you to do that particular video?
Well, all I'm saying is we can attach a video. You can either record the video with your built-in camera and then attach it to the tweet, or you can record it at the moment that you're going to tweet, and then that'll get saved to your camera roll. And then, yes, you can use it on any other venue as well. It's not just locked to Twitter.
Yes.
It actually shortens it for you. See, I'm going to make up a link here. Yes, but look at this. I'm tweeting here a really, really, really long link, and my address and my character count is not going down. So it's going to shorten it for me anyway. And yes, there's such a thing as Bitly, but we don't have to quite worry about it yet. The point is that if you add any link that is 200 characters long over the limit, it will automatically shorten it down to like 15 or 17 or something, no matter how long it is, and then you still have space for more of your tweet. And there was, yes, a question.
Our business has a YouTube channel, mm-hmm. and when I put videos on YouTube on either other sites or appliances and things that we use, mm-hmm. whatever, on there, on the YouTube, then I just click share, mm-hmm. and share it with Twitter, with our blog, Facebook, everything.
That's a very good point. So if you heard that, YouTube gives you the way to share directly into Twitter. If you've got a Twitter channel, even if you don't have if you've got a YouTube channel, or even if you don't have a YouTube account, there's still going to be a button that says share on Twitter. That's what I said earlier when I showed my blog. Remember, on our blog, we've got all of those posts, and then we've got buttons right there, share on Twitter. So if you wanted to share a 20-minute video, you can upload it to YouTube and share your link from YouTube, and you've got a 20-minute video on Twitter. You're not limited to the 30-second one that you record through the app. Yes?
You edit a tweet once you send it?
Unfortunately, no. So that's one of the things. Once you publish a tweet, you can either delete it, and I'll show you how, or move on. You cannot go back and edit your tweets, unfortunately. When I started using Twitter in 2009, that would also burn me up. Like, I had a great tweet. This was a great witty tweet. Whoops, I misspelled your. So I can't go back to edit it. The closest is I can delete it, tweet it again, tweet it correctly, spell check it. Yes?
The email address for the site that launched, shortened, did you have it click here, or was it a hyperlink?
Well, it'll become a hyperlink automatically. Again, if I've got an address here, yoursite.com, my long address that just goes on and on, that's a live link. I don't have to click anything about read more, view more, follow this link. It's going to be a live link. Notice that it's blue. So when I tweet it, people will see this tweet. They'll see that human address, or actually it will be shortened for me automatically. Then they'll be able to follow it. So there's no extra effort on our part to make it obvious for people to click on. It will be an active link with the little finger when you put your mouse on it, and it will not eat up more of your character count, no matter how long it is. So we have the option of text, we have the option of links. I just wrote a link. You can copy a link. So if you're on some website, so let's say from this blog post, I want to share this on Twitter. Yeah, we have the share button right there on Twitter, but let's say there is no share button. You usually can also simply copy the address of any website or anything on a website. So I'm copying that address from a website, and I can paste it into my tweet. Copy and paste. So that's how I can share any content on a tweet. Some content shows up as a nicely formatted tweet, meaning if I share a YouTube video, Twitter has a bit of a partnership with YouTube, so if you share a link to a video on Twitter, it will automatically show up as a little thumbnail preview. Click play, and it'll play right on the tweet. There's other such connections that are built in. There used to be a connection between Twitter and Instagram, where if you shared your Instagram photo, it would show up as a little preview right there on the tweet. I don't remember which of the two did it, but either Instagram or Twitter canceled that, and now you don't see Twitter, now you don't see Instagram photos on Twitter. You still see the link, and a person has to click it and then go to Instagram and view it. But it used to be you would see the Instagram photo right embedded into the tweet. Hopefully they do that again one day. Unfortunately, they probably won't because they're rival social networks. And they let the YouTube work because YouTube is perhaps a great revenue source for them, so they're letting that. So I'm just gonna, this is gonna be a tweet at the moment for myself. Again, think about why would people care? Tweet, I added a link. All of our 170-something followers would see that. Click tweet. That's why we want followers. I want to get more followers to see that these classes are there for free for people. That's why you want followers when you tweet, sale this Saturday, or here's a coupon, 10% off. Your followers, some amount of them, you might have 100, so only 2 or 1 follows through. You've got 500, well, maybe, you know, 20 follow through. You've got 1,000, well, maybe 200 follow through. Only 200 customers. So the more followers you get, the more numbers you have, because it doesn't work that I've got 174 followers, therefore I've got 174 customers. No, the number is much, much lower, especially for your product or your brand or whatever. So my advice is you've got your profile set up. You're going to publish 3 to 5 tweets. That was a text tweet with a link. Maybe I'll find a YouTube video and also tweet that. Maybe I'll take a photo on my phone and tweet it directly from my phone. Let's do that, actually. I'm going to tweet from my phone to the company page. That's why you want to get the app. Everyone smile, say social media.
Or we're just going to be a bunch of screens.
So I'm going to tweet that. Let's do that one more time. I have my finger on the lens. So I'm going to let that tweet. That'll show up in a moment here that there's a brand new tweet. But this is why you would want the app, because then it's more immediate. You have right on your app the ability to take a photo, take a video, publish something, and then it shows up for your followers. Question.
If you're posting for your blog or whatever an article or a photo or thing a day, so you create it, you have to go to Twitter, go to your blog, go to Google. Can you, you have to go into each one of them separately and post the same blog if you're doing it like that, or how can you do it automatically? I was just curious.
Yeah, so that's a good question about, well, I'm trying to manage a bunch of social networks at once. How do I manage it easily? I'll mention it now and I'll mention it again. You want to look into this website that is a multi-social media manager. It's called BufferApp.com. BufferApp.com. What they're about is you connect your Twitter, you connect your Facebook, you connect your Google Plus, you connect your Pinterest, you connect your networks, the big ones, not every single one of them, unfortunately. But you connect the four big networks, and then when you publish something into Buffer, it automatically goes to all your networks. So you don't have to be chained to every network to publish something.
Multiple network media settings.
Yes. Posting to multiple social media simultaneously. Exactly.
Do they charge?
The free plan lets you manage one of each. But I might have two Twitter accounts and three Facebooks for some reason. So then there's a paid version. I don't remember the price, but it's usually about $9 a month or maybe more. So yeah, there's a paid version, there's a free version. The free version should probably work for just about everyone. BufferApp.com. Oh, and now they've got Buffer.com. They used to not have Buffer.com. I guess they bought it, they got it back. It used to be BufferApp.com. But just Buffer.com. There's other platforms that will do this also. You may have heard of other ones. Hootsuite, that's another one. There's many ways to do the same task, some of them better than others, some of them more free than others. There's many tasks. I mean, many ways. I don't know them all. I can mention a couple, but this is one that we use all the time. Question?
Yeah, I'm sorry if you said this already, but if you're looking at the people who follow you and you're trying to do a sort geographically, if you click on their summary and it does not list a location, is there any way to dig further and find the location, or if it's not listed, it's just not listed?
No, if they didn't put a location, there's no way to get the location. They chose not to have it. So it would be a privacy nightmare for Twitter to force everyone's location to be visible. If I don't want my location visible, Twitter respects that. It's not visible.
But I mean, as a basic account, like you don't, like no address exists for you. I'm not talking about the posts themselves. I'm just talking about.
No, that's what I'm saying. A person can fill out the biography and all of that stuff however they want, and therefore they might fill in nothing at all. So there's nothing there. So I like Buffer because you can then blast out everything to all the networks at once or schedule it. Let's say I don't want to be chained to my computer anyway. I want to schedule it that once a week it will do something for me. Once a week it will post something to all networks, but then I will say once a day it will do something to Twitter specifically. Because Twitter is such short messages, such short attention span, that it might behoove me to try to do something every other day on Twitter instead of once a week. Like maybe Google Plus or Facebook. It's perfectly fine to post something once a week on Facebook and Google Plus. For Twitter, once a week might be a little minimal. Once a day is great. That's still a lot of work. So as beginners, to shoot for once a week is good. More than that, better. Yes.
So I know you mentioned that it's better to have more followers, obviously, than following, but in the beginning, when you're trying to build your audience, aren't you doing it by following people and hoping that they'll follow you back? So then you just go and drop them?
Yeah, so let's say we spend the time to write a few tweets, 3 to 5 tweets. We post pictures, maybe a video, maybe some links. Like right here, we say we've been using Trello to get organized, and it's work. That blog will go out on time this month. And then so, you know, someone gave it a favorite. Maybe, and I'll mention about how do you mention another Twitter account. It's very easy, but I'll get to that. So let's say I'm posting content. Okay, now my account doesn't look like a ghost town. So we'll talk about some tactics to then get more followers. One of those tactics, very easy to do actually, might not be the most effective, but it's a starting point. The starting point is start to follow a bunch of accounts. There is going to be a limit. I believe the limit is 200 per day. Twitter will not let you follow a lot of accounts in one day, but 200 is a lot. So one way is to start to follow a bunch of accounts. How do you know what to follow? Well, you've got search at the top right, not in your web browser, search in Twitter. So let's say I'm looking for, you can search for keywords, you can search for phrases. Let's see what happens if I search for I need a website. People might have tweeted that exact phrase. I need a website. Not that. And so the thing then that pops up here might be relevant to my company. Let's see. I need another website client soon. Web development by this. I need a good website to view and buy bikinis. I need a new website. I need you to design and build it. The budget is $10 to $30. So I'm searching. This is unfiltered, and again, hopefully none of this is not safe for work, because it is a public forum. So I'm going to be searching up on the search box over here, a keyword, a phrase, a question, something. I'm going to be searching. I'm going to get lots of results, and then I'm going to decide, okay, well, this person is talking about what I'm talking about. Then I can click on their profile and click follow. Depending on your web browser, if you hover your mouse on top of a profile, you might get the pop-up automatically. I noticed that not everyone has this, but if you hover over a particular profile, you might get a pop-up, a quick pop-up of their preview of their biography. If you don't get the pop-up, you can click their icon, and then you'll get the you'll get that, which shows me what their Twitter name is, where they're at, perhaps, if they've got a link, bio, their latest tweets, so then I can decide, okay, follow. Because to simply blindly follow 200 is a waste of your time. You're going to need to do a little bit of research about who to follow. So I am browsing here people that are mentioning website, but I'm not just going to click follow, follow, follow. Some will never follow me back. I wasted my time. I'm going to need to look at a few, and then decide to follow a few of these. Question?
Now, is this the point where you tell us to stay away from controversial, political, or hot button social issues associated with nothing to do with our business that we may happen to believe in or hate?
That has to do with your particular business. You might have heard of the term, you know, there's no such thing as bad publicity. So if you're trying to attract followers and so forth, and you are then connecting with controversial accounts or tweets or interacting with controversial people, that might get you followers. But is it going to get you the followers that you care about? Really, you have to decide with your particular company. So you have to decide what's best for your company. I'm trying to find those for a classroom setting that I can show in a classroom setting. But you have to decide which of those would matter to you. Yes.
And on that round thing where you can block an account, how radical is that? I mean, if you just have a business that you don't particularly want to hear from, do you want to go as far as to actually block it because, yeah, I don't know.
The only reason, the only way you would see something that you don't want to is if you're searching like this or if you have followed an account. So if you're seeing stuff from a business you don't want to see, you can unfollow or you can block. So you have to decide which of those is the best for you. Right here I'm seeing everything because I chose to do a broad search. Maybe that's too broad, and so I see everything. Things maybe that I don't, that I won't care about. And I have a couple of options. I can ignore it and move on, and my life is better. Or I can click the block, and I'll make sure I never see that again, but I'll probably never see them again, lost in the sea of 300 other million users. So you have to decide if you want to block an account or not, and it really depends on the circumstances at that moment. Yes?
You're there, and you want to follow. How do we do that?
Well, let's say this particular person I want to follow, so if you click on them, click on their icon or their name, you'll get the preview of what they're about. They're a web developer and a WoW player and so forth. Okay, maybe I do want to connect with them. Follow. So you're going to see a follow button next to their profile. Some of you will see that if you hover over the icon, you will get the follow button automatically, but some of you don't. Question?
If you, does it keep track of your searches?
It does. If I click back to go home, and then the search gets blank, right? So then if I click there, it did remember my recent search, and then I can clear those searches. If I forgot what I searched for, it's going to remember what I searched for recently, which could be convenient or embarrassing. That's why there's clear all. So one tactic is to search on Twitter, search these keywords and concepts, and then go to these accounts and click follow. Follow relevant accounts, but don't blindly click follow. You want to read what their tweet was, and even better, you want to click to see a preview and really see about them. Okay, what's their biography? What are their recent tweets? Okay, I like that recent tweet, but their other seven tweets are way too controversial, so maybe I won't follow. Notice also when you do the little bit of research here, so I'm looking at this person here, Megan Johnson, and notice, okay, full name is Megan Johnson, Twitter name is Tipsy Writer. It doesn't have to be the same. It can be different. Maybe her persona throughout all of the social networks is Tipsy Writer, just like on her website. So she's using her real name there. And as I look here, her stats are 16,000 tweets, following 28,000 accounts, and has 36,000 followers. So I'm going to follow accounts, but if I take a quick look at their stats, this will give me an indication, more of an indication, if I might get a follow back. The point of me following 200 accounts is some of those accounts will follow me back. I don't know how many. It really depends who you're following. Maybe it's going to be 7 out of 200, but those 7 are very valuable and they buy your product. You won't know until you start to do following. Question?
So from some of my experience seeing some companies, sometimes you'll see them say have like 500 followers and then they follow like 5,000 people. And to me, that kind of makes it seem like they're like almost trying too hard for followers rather than like their product is good. They're just getting followers from following a ton of people. So I think it's got to be like a good average.
Exactly. That's a very good point. You're going to see that and you don't want to become that. You don't want to follow 5,000 accounts and you've only got 500 followers or 200 followers. That will show then other people they seem desperate or they seem like a spam account. Here, there's a bit of a balance. She's followed 28,000. You might get a follow back. She's prone to following accounts, but probably will follow accounts that really she cares about writing, or what else here? Naps and sports and sparkles. So you might get followed if you're really into what she's into. She's prone to following a lot of people. But she still has more than 10,000, almost 10,000 more followers than she is following. So her ratio is good. She's got more followers than following. And you want that too. You want more followers than you're following. Obviously, in the beginning, you're going to have 200 followers. You're going to have 200 following and 7 followers, perhaps. And perhaps you will look spammy. That's why I'm saying this might not be the best technique. You can always go back and unfollow. You can give them maybe 1 or 2 days. They haven't followed me back, unfollow. That's a possibility as well. You know, we can easily, once you've followed an account, I'm going to give this a try. Well, let me do it for one that doesn't seem that good. So this person, okay, 5 and 6. Yay, you just got a follower, Sunny. So, obviously, like I said, you should then vet who you're following. Let's say I followed them. They don't follow me within a day. I can easily go back. Oops. I can easily go back to the to my following screen. I can go back to my following screen, and these are the accounts that I'm following, and then unfollow. That's it. So now I've unfollowed that account. Another account gets a notification that they have been followed. Yes, but they do not get a notification that they've been unfollowed. Now there is a limit to that as well. Twitter will see something's going on if you followed 500 accounts and then an hour later you unfollowed 400 of them. Spam. So again, you're gonna follow a few accounts, maybe make a goal to follow 20 accounts every day. That's definitely below the threshold. It might be a little slower, but you'll then not be marked as a spam account. Every day, do a little research to follow 20 accounts. Then take stock at the end of the week. How many followed you back? Because you're going to see on your screen you're going to see on your screen here who follows you. So you're not going to be in the dark if there was, if they followed you, you followed them back. So Vicky followed us back. Ah, the Union Tribune hasn't followed us back for some reason.
Where does it show that they followed?
This shows you, in first of all, let's do this. Go to your home button, your home screen, and then click following to see everyone that you're following. And then if they are following, next to their name there, they will say, following you. Trello is not following us. Bill Bolden is following us.
Do I have a little check mark?
No, it'll say, following you. The check mark is something else. But this is, they're following us. Barry Feldman doesn't have the check mark, but it says, follows you.
So where's the check mark?
As I said previously, there might be more than one Justin Bieber on Twitter, but there's only one Justin Bieber that is Justin Bieber. So the official verified account will have a check mark, and not everyone can get that. That's more for like celebrities and such that always are getting, you know, spoofed on Twitter. Now, I have on my blog, my company blog, we have a Twitter top 10 blog post, or top 5, just like Google Plus. So there's a Twitter article there. I'll talk about some of these in a bit. But back on our company blog, there's a blog post about Twitter that will have some usefulness for you. One of the tactics, as I said, start to follow accounts related to what your company is about. 20 a day is good. Take stock at the end of the week. How many never followed me back? Okay, unfollow. They don't get the notification. A better tactic to get followers is, if you go back to the home screen, and in my blog post, it's basically what I'm going to talk to you about, number one, join the conversation. If you go back to your home screen, you're going to see the tweets of the accounts that you're following. These tweets show up here of accounts that you're following. Sometimes you see tweets that from accounts you're not following because they might be promoted or they might be retweeted. I'll talk about retweets in a bit. But here's a better tactic to get more followers. You followed, for example, Mashable for a reason. I mentioned Mashable previously in that they're a great website that publishes a lot of content about social media, technology, and all of that. I followed Mashable because I care about what they're posting. So one tactic is, who else cared about that latest tweet? Remember, as I said, I'm going to try to go down here. 40 expressive Walking Dead fan artworks. It's elementary. Dear QuickBooks user, guess this famous freelancer. So I'm following these accounts, I'm seeing their tweets, and if I see these tweets, other people saw these tweets, I want to see, who are these other people? For example, Google Analytics published something here. The headlines say, analyze your content marketing and see what performs well to meet your goals using data. Okay, that really resonated with people. 18 favorites, 12 retweets, and some amount of replies that you will see if you click on the blank part of a tweet. That's kind of weird, but you click on a blank part of the tweet and then it opens up to show you that Tippamanzi Adventures replied. I wish they would show a number there so I don't have to click, perhaps. But this is showing, look at all of these people that interacted with that tweet. These people might be better for me to follow because they took the time to interact with something that I also care about. So let's see here. MonsterSocial.net, Julie Leary, Gilbert Algordo. This is a Google admin, time traveler, financial analyst. He's following 2,000 accounts and has 1,500 followers. From this ratio, I can see he might be more apt to follow. He seems to be tweeting in Tagalog, so I might not be able to understand the tweets, but if I click follow, so now he got a notification that says PMD Interactive followed you. And maybe he'll follow back. Question?
So if you have like a thousand, even 10,000 followers, how do you organize this? Like, how do you find the one right away? I wonder.
Unfortunately, you cannot organize your followers. It's just going to be a big, long list of all your followers. There's no way to organize them in that screen. We can use something called lists, but that's also not automatic. You have to, when, if we get to talk about lists, we can put these 7 people in this list about, you know, cat people, and these 40 ones into dog people, but it's not automatic. So that's a thing that they should improve.
So you just said that in your follow them conversations, like, say, what they bring up, right? So how do you automatically see this kind of stuff?
How do you automatically what?
See this kind of stuff. They watch. Like, I just don't understand if you follow these people, so what?
One of the reasons to follow people is for them to follow you back. That's the big thing. When you follow any account, you're going to see their tweets. Now, that's why we want to follow people that are relevant and related to what my company is about. I don't just want to click follow, 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 because then I'll get junk in my timeline. So it does take that extra effort to first follow relevant accounts.
Share information.
Does that answer the question? Question in the corner over there? Do you guys have a question over there? Do you guys have a question over there? I'm hearing a lot of chatter out there. Question?
Maybe you clicked on maybe you spoke to this already, but if I click on my list of following, it comes up and there's a lot of spots that are waiting for me to click follow. So Is that the advertising, their promotional?
Under following?
Yeah, they're my following. And they don't have that following blue thing eliminated that it just says follow, like it's asking you to follow.
It shouldn't. This screen should only show you who you have followed.
Yeah.
Unless you were here and you've unfollowed them. Like this.
Mm-hmm. Right.
If I don't want to follow Gilbert anymore, I turn that off and now it says follow. When you refresh your screen, then they'll go away. So now Gilbert doesn't show up there anymore and doesn't ask you to follow anymore because I've unfollowed.
Oh, no, yeah. Okay, that explains it.
Mm-hmm. So to hammer the point in again, look at the tweets of the accounts that you're following, like right here, Q&A. What happened to the government's small business loans? Okay, so if I click on the tweet to expand it, it'll show me it's got 8 retweets, 5 favorites, no comments, but these people right here have interacted with that tweet. So I might want to look into who's James Bregenzer. Maybe it's something that they would care about what I'm tweeting about. So I'm gonna take a quick look. Serial entrepreneur and new dad. And he's got following 600, followers 5,000. I could click follow, and maybe I will be his 601st that he's following, but I better have good content because he seems more selective. He's got, what is that, almost 10 times more followers than following. So his ratio is that he's got many more followers. Many more people think he's more interesting than he is following. He's more selective. Eventually, you want to be that way too, but we're just starting off. You know, in the company here, we're following 106. There's 70 that we never followed because, for whatever reason, their content we don't believe is relevant enough to see it all the time. And just kind of arbitrarily, we're at the moment, we're trying to always be at 100 following. Right now there's 6 that we've gone over the limit, then we're going to weed them out. Just arbitrarily, there's no real reason to this. But we've chosen that we're always going to be following about 100 accounts, and then we're always going to have a higher ratio. That, of course, takes that time and effort of following, and then unfollowing, and following, and unfollowing. So that's why, again, remember how amazing Google Plus communities were? You go directly to where all the people are. Here, you have to do searching, you have to do fishing, or poaching, however you want to call it. In this case, I often, however, call it fishing. I'm doing fishing, I'm putting out these lures, I'm trying to catch these fish. Some I'm going to toss back, and some I'm going to keep. And some are going to be a nice fillet. So I'm playing that game. I'm following some accounts, and I'm unfollowing other accounts. You want to be careful. Somewhere in the Twitter help screen, it does tell you exactly. If you follow and unfollow this amount of people, we're going to block you. But that's why I'm being conservative, because I don't remember the number right now. 20 per day is a good goal, so that you don't seem like a spammer.
So I have a number of people who are unfollowing. Is there a way of figuring out if I want to drop some of them? What's the best way to figure out which ones to drop without harming my...
There's this great website. This is one you should make a note of. It's called manageflitter.com. ManageFlitter is free to a certain point. What this will do is it will analyze, once you approve it, it will analyze all that you're following and all that you have followers, and it will give you recommendations of who to unfollow. You can try it live right now, actually. I'll show you. ManageFlitter.com. I'm going to click Start. Connect to Twitter. It's going to start to analyze the accounts. And then on the left side, it will give me a bunch of filters to help me decide who to unfollow. It's going to give me a list of these are the people that are not following me back. So instead of me browsing that screen that I showed you previously and looking for those that are not following, this will give me that list. And then I can easily, from here, click unfollow, unfollow. But this also then, you know, tells me more information about their biography and when they last tweeted, how long they've been on Twitter and such. So this still does not replace using our own effort to know who to unfollow. But this gives us filters to figure this out. Like, maybe I followed a bunch of accounts and I accidentally followed accounts with no image. Because oftentimes those that still have the little egg icon are spam accounts. So I don't recommend following the egg accounts because they're probably spam. If you want to confirm you didn't follow any of those accounts, you can go there to no profile image and it'll show you. These are the accounts that are probably spam. More specifically, they have an algorithm that tries to tell you these accounts are probably spam. So let's see if any of them at the moment here, fake following, nothing shows up. We've already weeded it out. And notice there's one that's fake followers and fake following, but the fake followers is for pro and you have to pay for some of these features. You'll be able to do this pretty well with all of the free features. Maybe you can select inactive, and this will show you these are the accounts that don't tweet that often. Unfortunately, like GigaOhm, because they were shut down. Vicky hasn't tweeted that recently. It tells you what was the last tweet and such. Greg hasn't tweeted that recently. So then I can select to unfollow these. We've got a following ratio. A high ratio. Show all the people who follow more people than are following them. So I can go here to high ratio and then let's see how many, a few of these. So effective UI. If you hover over, it'll tell you. It says this account is following 9,000 and they have 8,000 followers. That's close enough. I think that's a little too draconian. The ratio isn't that off. If they were following 9,000 and they had 90 followers, okay, that's definitely a skewed ratio. But following 9,000 and have 8,000 followers, that's about 1,000 in there, so that's not so bad. Over here, former student. He's following 1,600, he's got 1,000 followers. 600 is not so bad again.
So does Google use that data to decide to start penalizing you?
I don't think so. Google has many other factors that it takes into account. This might be one of the factors, but I haven't read too much documentation that this is a big factor at the moment. So, colleague Chuck, he's a superstar on social media. He's following at the moment a little bit double, 800 on top of 400. So technically the ratio is about 2 to 1. So that's a little high, but this is really a good contact to have. So you have to decide what this is. Again, this is not going to be smart enough for every situation, but this is going to guide you toward making decisions of who to follow or unfollow. Yes?
Is one of the factors that you should take into consideration is if you look at your Twitter link, your feed, if one particular someone you're following is totally dominating it so that you're not seeing anything else other than just them?
That's a good point. That is a mark of a particular Twitter account, perhaps just engaging too much in a dialogue, in a monologue than a dialogue. Remember, I mentioned last week, if you weren't here, we can run social media as a monologue or as a dialogue. If we're running it as a monologue, we're always posting something, tweeting a picture, putting on Google Plus something, on Facebook, just one way. We're just blasting stuff out to the world, to our followers. We never reply, we never retweet or share, we're just talking to the audience. I run social media personally and we run it for our businesses, we run it as a dialogue. We put out a question, we put out a tweet, we engage with an audience, we reply. We're not just blasting out 10 things every day or one thing every day, we're also replying to people. So if you're seeing that on your timeline here, your home screen, one account is over and over and over, that is also an indication that they're a bit more of a spam account. maybe accidentally, but they're having a monologue on social media, and I don't respond to that very well. I would rather have an account that is more of a dialogue, that they do reply, that they post stuff judiciously, not every hour on the hour, just to try to get more followers. Then their account is not too relevant to my purposes, so unfollow. So apparently today is National Tequila Day. And then this is an article, how to make a decent margarita for once. Perfect on a Friday. Retweet. So there's a lot to this stuff. That's why, very quick sidebar, I teach this class. It's two sessions long. I also teach a version of this class at Southwestern College. Now that class is 15 weeks long. And in that class, we can get into much more detail about our social networks. But in that class, we do also have homework, and it is for college credit and so forth. I'll mention the class again, but it's going to be open for the next semester, fall semester in August. So if you're interested in a much more fuller featured class, I'm teaching it at Southwestern College. It's not a free class. I believe the classes at Southwestern, I believe, are $40 a unit, and this is a 3-unit class, so that's $120. But it's a 15-week class where we go into a lot of detail, a lot of one-on-one. You get homework so that then you apply what you're learning and you get really good at this. Because we're going to spend 3 hours, 3.5 hours on Twitter today, there's still a lot to talk about. I could spend the whole 2 months of this class just on Twitter. But I want to give you an overview of as many social networks in the 2 months that we have here for you to decide. I'm really liking YouTube. I'm going to concentrate on YouTube. Great. I'm really liking Google Plus and Twitter. I'm going to do both. Great. Better than, I've got a website, why don't I have traffic? Because you're not on social media. Question?
Are we going to do something later, talk about hashtags?
Yes, we're going to talk about hashtags right now. I'm posting stuff on Twitter. You might see people posting stuff on Twitter. You might see something with a little number symbol. That's a hashtag. It's a keyword. It's something that I add to a tweet. I'll show you how to do it in one moment. But it's a keyword that is an active link. This person, Susan, tweeted, "Great article on Virgin by Jack Preston on how to create the perfect business plan. Hashtag entrepreneur." So this is a dense tweet. It has a link to something, an article or something. FB.me usually tells me it's going to Facebook. This one has a link over to San Diego Union Tribune. Okay, so it's got a link. It's then also got two hashtags, business and entrepreneur. If I click on any one of those hashtags, what basically appears is a screen of search results with the hashtag entrepreneur. If I click on the hashtag business, I get a search result of hashtag business. So a hashtag is an active link on your tweet, a keyword on your tweet. And the purpose of that is then that this is now connecting me with a bunch of other people throughout Twitter that are also using that hashtag. This is why TV shows and movies and radios are always saying about hashtag this and hashtag that, because then it's bringing everyone together to the closest analogy of a community. We have communities in Google+. We have, in a sense, hashtags on Twitter. If people are tweeting and adding that specific hashtag, everyone is in on that conversation. And this is live, because as I've been talking, 19 new tweets have been published with business.
So who created the original hashtag?
I don't think there's a way to know about that very easily, because anyone can create a hashtag anytime they want. But that doesn't mean the hashtag will take off or be relevant or be used. That's why they mention it on the news broadcast, hashtag NBC7. That's why they mention it for the movie, hashtag the gallows. That's why they mention it on a business card or on a flyer or whatever, because they want to get that hashtag out and become a thing and be relevant and used. 13 more hash. 13 more tweets.
Send to that community, whatever you have to do, make your tweet go to that community.
But don't think about it exactly as a community, because there's no room, there's no actual place like a Google Plus community. It's just that it's a search results page. This is a page of search results with that hashtag. So in a sense, you can think of it like a community, but it's not exactly like a Google Plus community, but everyone. But it's a search result with that hashtag. Possibly, because this hashtag, in this case, is so generic. Yes, a lot of people are going to be using the hashtag, the message is going to be very diluted. But that's why MTV has the hashtag, you know, MTV Scream. They've crafted a hashtag. They could have hashtagged it Scream. And that is going to then get so diluted because people are just going to use that hashtag for whatever. But they invented a hashtag called hashtag MTV Scream. And therefore, everyone is in on the conversation that they're trying to direct. And this is what I said previously. You cannot control your message as effectively on Twitter. You just can't. You can control it more effectively on Facebook and Google+, because you can create a community, you can delete comments, you can control it. Here, you cannot delete anyone's tweet. And if your hashtag gets away from you, it got away from you. Think of a new one. So you want to perhaps craft a hashtag, like I can make up a hashtag right now called PMD Business. No one's going to know about it, but the more I tweet about it, if I use it more on Twitter, if I use it on Google+, if I put it on our business card, if I put it on our website, on our blog, I'm trying to get traction for it. But anyone can make up a hashtag. I'll show you how in a moment.
So it improves your search results.
It could. Or it could get your message lost when someone else takes over your hashtag. Like the police department happens. You know, my NYPD got co-opted by people showing not positive things about the NYPD. Okay, time to start over. That hashtag is done. Question?
So using your example, is it something that you just thought of, or that exists somewhere already? So can you, in the middle of the thought, go, I'm going to do hashtag this, and suddenly an act of like,
that's the thing. Business is so generic, so broad, it's going to get away from me. I want to craft a more personal hashtag. So to create one, I'm going to click on the top right here on tweet. I'm going to write a brand new tweet and say, we are enjoying Periscope live. So if I start to write the hashtag, which is Shift 3, the number 3 has the number symbol, right? So Shift 3 starts to write a hashtag. Then I can write something here. My idea was to make hashtag live video. As I'm typing, it's suggesting these are hashtags right now that have some activity. Do you want to tap into an existent hashtag? That might be useful. But again, it might be way too broad. Or I can continue to keep typing and make my own up here. Live video. It's suggesting live video chat seems to be active. But it might be, unfortunately, connecting to adult live video chat. I don't know. So then I would want to do a little bit of research. Up on the search box at the top right, search that hashtag. See what other people are typing. If it's all adult stuff, then don't use it. So, the hashtags can be very powerful, they can be very confusing, they can be very useful, they can be very worthless. You can make up your own hashtag whenever you want. I'm going to call this PMD Live Video Chat. Probably no one else in the world has ever made that up, so therefore there's no tweets related to this. So now it's up to me to try to get that hashtag to go viral, which of course is easier said than done. If you tap into existing hashtags relevant to your product or brand or your idea here, then that could then connect you with the other people in the quote-unquote community using that hashtag. But again, that particular hashtag might not be relevant to you, might be too broad, might be already tainted by negativity, negative press. So maybe before just simply adding it in here, I would do the search up here. hashtag live video. I hope I don't regret this, but I'm going to search for hashtag live video. Put the finger on the back button, ready here. So live video here, Fox 6, courtroom and jail following death of Sandra Bland. I am Jason Nelson, live video. Doggies. So that particular hashtag maybe might not serve me as much as I thought, so it's up to me to do the research on a hashtag. It's just a simple search, hashtag, search for that hashtag. You'll see results and you'll see if that hashtag is relevant to you. If not, make your own up, but then now you've got the uphill battle of making that hashtag relevant. Yes?
You suggested that you don't want to use one if it's become corrupt. Mm-hmm. How do you get rid of one? Or can you?
Can't. Just don't use it.
It's out there forever.
Mm-hmm. It's out
how
there
does
forever.
It work if you hashtag on Facebook? How does that connect them to
well, each one... Facebook and Google Plus and Twitter and such, they're their own walled gardens. They're their own social networks, and they're in competition. So if I hashtag inbound15 on Twitter, that does not connect with any content on Facebook. If I go to Facebook and post something on Facebook called hashtag inbound15, that does not connect back to Twitter. It's only going to show me the Facebook posts on Facebook with that hashtag. The Twitter posts on Twitter will show up with that hashtag. The Google Plus hashtags will only show up on Google Plus. All the networks nowadays use hashtags, but they keep you within their walled garden of their network. They're not cross-platform. That's why MTV is promoting MTV, hashtag MTV Scream, but they're promoting it on their Facebook, on their Twitter, on their Instagram, on their Snapchat, or whatever, everywhere, so that wherever the person is at, they see the message. The message will not travel automatically from network to network. So then the question is, okay, great, I'm going to use 10 hashtags. I'm going to get lots of followers that way. No, you're going to look like a spammer. So I recommend up to three maximum hashtags per tweet. Lifehacker right here, they had one hashtag. Susan, a moment ago, had two hashtags. If I see a tweet that's got seven hashtags and barely enough space to write something else, I think that's spammy. And I don't want you to be spammy. So don't fill your tweets with seven hashtags or 12 hashtags. Three at the most. One is good. Two is okay. Three is pushing it.
Is that per day or just?
Per tweet.
Per tweet?
Yeah, but then if every single one of your hashtags, every single one of your tweets has the maximum of three, there's something to say about that also. It's a big balancing act. So three per tweet is what I would say. And the way to figure out, well, what's how am I going overboard? How am I doing it wrong? One of the reasons for you to follow accounts, especially bigger names, is to see how are they doing it. Get inspiration to see how they're doing it. Lifehacker right here is a great website, not about technology really, but, well, if we click their bio, they'll tell us themselves. Don't live to geek, geek to live, which still doesn't tell me much, but what they're about is they're giving tips and advice and interesting things to do, like how to reuse that old laptop, how to, you know, this is a life hack, if you haven't heard of that term. Life hacks are just interesting things to do to maybe repurpose something. Like there's so many life hacks about IKEA furniture. That desk, you, with a little bit of hacking, you can make it into a wonderful cat tree. You know, life hacking. Don't throw those batteries out. Wrap three of them together, and then that becomes a super battery. I don't know, but all of these life hacks to do things. So here they're saying, how to make a decent margarita for once. So a life hack. How to make the best margarita, because they're going to tell you, use this and use that and stir it this way. You've been doing it wrong. But anyway, look at the accounts that you have followed. Hopefully you follow them for a reason, because they have relevant things. Look at how they tweet. And you then get inspiration by that too. She didn't go overboard with three tweets, but she had a link back to her post. The let's see this one. Swift workshop in Denver looks great. That one had no hashtags. That's fine. No hashtags is fine. But a link over for the whole article. Swift is Apple's programming language to make apps. So there seems to be a workshop on how to learn that. And there's a link on how for me to learn myself. So look at what your competition or your peers are doing. To get inspiration. So for example here, Wired is using the New Horizons hashtag. The little spaceship we sent 9 years ago has finally reached Pluto, and it's been taking some amazing photos. If you haven't paid attention in the news, you're very lucky. We're all very lucky. We are the first humans ever to see the surface of Pluto. Pluto wasn't even discovered until 1930. So we didn't even discover this planet until the 20th century. The ancients never knew about Pluto. And we, in our lifetimes, know about it, and we're seeing the surface of it, of a planet, what was it, 3 billion miles away. And so everyone's using the hashtag New Horizons to share all of this stuff about that little ship that could.
But that New Horizons is only on Twitter.
That same hashtag, I don't doubt that it's also on Instagram and Facebook and everywhere. But this tweet right here with that hashtag probably only exists on Twitter. That exact same tweet or message or picture might not be on Instagram. And so this is how you entice people. Follow me on Instagram. Follow me on Twitter. Not by posting the exact same thing on every network. Because then say, why would I follow you on Twitter? I'm already following you on Instagram. You're going to post, ideally, different things on every network. And yes, that is 5 times the work because I'm on 5 networks. But you could get more clients that way. It's okay as a beginner to post the same thing on every network. Maybe jazz it up a little bit. Change it a little bit per network, which takes more work, of course. But at least you're on the right track if you're on social media. Question.
So just to leave this straight, so if you use a hashtag, that permanently attaches that to your search results on that media, you can't remove it.
It attaches it permanently to your tweet. So you cannot edit the tweet, you can delete the tweet.
Okay.
If you delete the tweet, then you're no longer part of that search, that big sea of search.
Okay,
with
so
that
it
hashtag.
Doesn't permanently adhere it to your business name.
Exactly.
Just
to that tweet. But then let's say, you know, taking it to the extreme, you used the hashtag a year ago, and now that hashtag has come back to life, and now it's a negative hashtag. Well, if someone is searching that negative hashtag and your tweet shows up from a year ago, it showed up. This is what I'm saying about Twitter being so open for positive and for negative. You might say, well, it's way too open. I can't control my message. Great, then use another network where you have more control. You say, well, why don't they change it to be like Facebook or Google Plus? Each network tries to provide social media in the best way that they feel is their way. They felt that 140 characters work best for them, especially 10 years ago when a lot of us didn't have smartphones. We had those flip phones when all we had was the simple number pad to send quick texts. So 140 characters was great. Now that a lot of us have smartphones and tablets, we want to write a whole essay, we still have only 140 characters. But we can add a link, we can add a video, we can add a photo. So we don't have that kind of limitation. Yes?
I have a question going back to the verified thing when you were talking about the movie stars. If I have a similar name to a competing company, can I go through a verified process for mine?
Unfortunately, verification really only applies to what Twitter themselves believe is important enough to verify. So, for example, this is Wired. You might never have heard of Wired before, but they're a big name in the world of technology, so they've been verified. Local news reporters, for example, with 500 followers might be verified because they might get spoofed and, you know, anyone can create an account, so someone creates another account of, you know, who's a current news reporter. And steal their profile in a sense. So to answer your particular one, you can try to get verified, but I wouldn't hold my breath.
And you do that by the petition process? Or?
Yes. You go over to twitter.com/verified. Twitter.com/verified. And then you tweet to them. Tweet to verified accounts. You'll send them a tweet and say, I would like to get verified. And again, depending on your stature, how big you are, if you're a big community pillar and all of that, you might get the verified. If you're just yet another giant Mike's Giant New York Pizza, they probably won't go through that process. So don't take it bad if you don't get verified, but that's the process. I think I've hit the big points I wanted to talk about. There's still many more things we could be talking about, but we've got 9 minutes left in class. So any final general questions about Twitter? Again, use it or lose it. So we created an account. You want to use it between now and next week. Ask questions, make notes, send me email, or ask in person, because I'm going to ask again next time in class any Twitter questions. But right now, any general Twitter questions? Anything that I couldn't quite get to, you can always search, right? Go to your favorite search engine and look up, what is a Twitter list? We didn't get a chance to talk about lists. You might want to look that up. What is a Twitter list? Look that up. That might be useful to you. I also mentioned Twitter lists in our blog post. We didn't quite get to it. Question?
Going back to the profile, you had hashtags in yours. Mm-hmm. So if somebody searches that hashtag, is it actually pulling up, it's going to pull up the company for them?
It could. So if you notice, we put in a hashtag, a couple of hashtags, in our profile. When I was editing the profile, here we go. We supported your success through individualized web solutions such as hashtag web design, hashtag development, and hashtag social media. Quick note, hashtags should not have spaces. If I wrote hash web space design, the hashtag is only hash web. The hashtag ends as soon as there's a space. So web design is one word run together. You can put capital letters, it doesn't matter, uppercase, lowercase. But capital letters are nice to be readable. It doesn't matter if you search hashtag web design capital letters or not. What matters is that web design is one word. Also social media, one word. Also be careful. Let me show you here specifically. If I'm writing hashtag web space design, look at how only web is blue, because only hash web, hashtag web, is the hashtag. With no space, the whole thing is a hashtag. Let's say we're doing Victor's Bakery. Okay, hashtag Victor's Bakery. Hashtag Victor's Bakery. See a difference?
Yeah.
That apostrophe ended the hashtag. So now the hashtag is hashtag Victor, not Victor's Bakery. So mark of a beginner is, I know hashtags. I'm going to start using hashtags. You put in an apostrophe or a dash or something, your hashtag is not complete. So no symbols, no characters. You can do numbers. Victor's One Bakery. Doesn't make sense. But you could do that. But no spaces and no special characters. MTV. So what's MTV doing recently? MTV crashes Plymouth, MTV hottest, MTV crashes, MTV MMA 2015. So as you start typing a hashtag, it will give you suggestions. There's what I'm saying, MTV screen. It's just on my mind because who would have thought that having a TV show based on a horror movie from the 90s would be popular? But apparently their Scream TV show is popular. It wasn't enough to have 4 movies. People want to watch it every week. Yes?
With regard to photos on your site, is it in your favor to change out your photos frequently? Like
on the profile?
Mm-hmm. you know, like they say to change things out on your website, or you know, Google likes that.
Yes, but Google doesn't like you just simply to change your background picture of your site. Google likes you to change your site as in adding blog posts and such. So I have to do the research. I don't believe that's very important. The content is what's important. So if you change your background picture and such every once in a while, that's nice. That's fine for your followers. They might see something new. That's interesting. But for your brand new potential followers, they never knew what the original looked like, so they wouldn't care. And for the search engines, I don't believe that's an important thing they look at. It's the content. Last question. Okay. Last question should be, when's lunch?